cleared the train. As you can see, it's pouring down the rain, which in all fairness we love, because it's good carp in weather, as they would say. 140 miles left. That isn't all that far, but we are going to stop after 70 miles and get... Hang on, overtake this lorry. Oh my God, you're in peril, aren't you? We are going to stop and have, we've discussed this by the way, a pan-air de chocolate and a nice cup of coffee. That'll be on the 70 mile an hour zone. So there you go. The roads over here are like glass. Why can't they be like that in England? If we go in England, it's like, oh, that, isn't it? And over here, it is. So truly, truly looking forward to this trip. As I said earlier, we've not visited this lake before, so it's new to us. Excited, really. A lot of big fish. Proper weather. Let's just see what that brings along. I'll update you when we've got our pan-air de chocolate. The aforementioned refreshment stop. Hot chocolate, latte for my man, and just, you've got to look at this bag. Just as well to give us a bag this size, because in it, hang on. How the hell does that work? What is wrong with a tiny little snack bag? But the pan de chocolate is a French speciality that you can't resist. Already scoffed one. Oh, look at that. 1 hour left on the sat nav. But we had to stop and get some of these. Look at the state of my van, man. This is OCD City. Look at it, what you're doing to my van. But we've just heard from Keith, Facebook. We're still coming out, and he's putting his makeup on in preparation for our arrival. So 1 hour left, and that's going down my Gregory. Thank you. Oh, no. Cheers, biggies. Cheers. Says Lac de Premiere Carp fishery, so I'm assuming we're in the right place. Although I've got to say, our sat nav, see this little lane up here, it's just brought us 2 kilometers down there like that. Whoa, it's like a scrambler. Now yesterday I washed my van, so when we get to Keith, I'm going to ask him to reimburse me for my van cleaning. So that is definitely, we need to find a different way out of here. So let's go and meet Keith Gladden. We are here. Had a word with Keith. We're going to start at peg 14. A lot of fish along this bank close in. We've got 14, 15, 16 at our disposal, because the only other lads that are coming in a couple of days have put the other bank. So without further ado, I'm getting down to 14. I'll try and catch a carp. Catch you later. Been here, I don't know, a couple of hours now in the swim. Looked like it was going to rain, so I threw the shelter up and sorted all the kit out. Threw the rods out quickly. Now it's completely flat bottom out here, between 5 and 6 foot. There's nothing out there, so bait is going to be obviously the feature that's going to draw them in, hopefully, fingers crossed. What I've done is on the left rod, I've done them all at 20 wraps, which is about 80 yards, and I've put on the left one a little pineapple and cream pop up with a split shot behind it and a little bit of plastic to turn it into a wafter, because it's all flat, it's like sandy bottom out there. And I put about 6 spombs. I blended up a bucket of 24/7 crumb, a couple of tins of the F1 corner, a bit of the F1 clear pellet oil in it. I'll show you that in a bit and knock up some more for later. I've put three or four, maybe five spawns right where the swan is now. There you go. The other ones, I've decided to put two on one spot. I've done about 15 spawns on that of the same stuff, the corn, the 24/7 crumb. And I've got a little pineapple cream waft with a bit of plastic again because there's a little corn in the mix. And the writing rod, I'm putting a little pink code red pop up on it. So I'm going to keep them tight. If I see fish, I'll quite happily move. If not, then hopefully the baited area will be, you know, our feature. It's not just nice and firm out there. So I say it's about between 5 and 6 foot. It's none of that. It's quite smooth and nice. So we're hoping for a quick bite, which we all do. Clearly didn't happen. I know Keith's had a couple of fish late evening and a couple in the night, so you know they may be. I know a lot of fish spend a lot of time over in them reef beds, so I don't want to go there just yet. We've got 4 days ahead of us, so we can use that a little bit later. I'm half hoping they move out of there in the dark hours, over a bed of bait, have a few bites, and in the morning we've got a couple of fish to show you. So till then, that's what I'm up to. I'm going to knock up another bucket of spod in a minute once I've done this other rod, and then it can sit there and soak up the corn water and the F1 pellet oil, ready for hopefully about a bite and we can top the swim up. Right, what have I done so far? I've whizzed up a load of 24/7 12 mils, these little critters, in the Ridge Monkey Muncher Feed. Brilliant bit of kit. So we've got a few bags of this in the van that I can use. Just want to create a load of smell. So we're going to stick about 3 kilos of Jamie Oliver, really, aren't I? But better looking. We've got about 3 key of crumbed up 24/7. Now, F1 corn is something I've used a huge amount in the last few years. And if I'm, well, home or away, it goes in. So I've left the fluid in it in this one. So I'm going to put in half a dozen tins. Okay. We'll give that a really good stir in. Now I do know in here they like a bit of sweet corn and they do like a bit of sweet bait, which is why I chose to use the 24/7 instead of my absolute favourite, which is our Code Red. So there you go, if that's what they like in here, that's what they like. Now give that a real good stir in, get all the dry powder from the bottom, because that F1 water, the salt, the sweet water out the tin, it's going to soak right into that crumb. Some I've used a lot in the past, I mean they've only just released this Sonia Bakes, it's a clear pellet oil with F1 again, it smells adoringly. So what this does is it clings to the product, it's quite a heavy oil, it'll help the product sink faster, massive of attraction coming out, and then the oil itself obviously will float because oil as a product is light. So we'll give this a good few squirts in there, a nice load of it, it just smells so lovely, and a good stir again. What you're doing is, you know, I'm not looking to feed these fish, I want to catch them. Now whether we catch them over this or not, we're going to try it because it's something I like doing. Lots and lots of attraction, a fair bit of corn in, obviously most of it is mush. Now that is lots, it's like you walking past a chippy, you might not be hungry, but that smell makes you feel hungry. That's what I'm hoping for, that's the effect I want. So we've got 6 tins of corn, three or four kilos, whatever it is, a crumb, and a big squirt of F1 clear pellet oil. So nice stir around, it's all mushy now. I'm going to risk throwing some in the edge because I love it. It just clouds up lovely. Loads of little bits all over the bottom. As I said earlier, we've got no features here, so we're creating our own. A nice big bucket of this out there. 2 rigs set on top of it. And I will let you know how I get on. Hopefully this evening we'll have a fish. If not, we'll talk to you again in the morning. Thank you. Morning. Well, unfortunately, nothing to report other than Ant having a 3-pound catfish yesterday evening while we was having our dinner. I heard a couple here in the night, but yesterday evening I walked up to peg 16, stood there for probably nearly an hour. Saw two fish, which we're being told is sort of the peg to be in, but we were going yesterday on what was going on here. So I'm going to justify the fact I've done a night here. I've seen four or five fish this morning from this area, but they're so far over that to cast or put the boat over there would interfere with Keith. I'm sure he had one in the night, but so that's out of the game. I've seen one this morning, show peg 16 water again. So it's early doors, it's 7 in the morning. I am going to give it a few hours here because it's obviously a good time for at home. It would be a brilliant time for a bite this time in the morning. I'm going to, it rained all night and all. What the hell is it with these weather, people? No rain for 4 days. It never stopped all night. Everything that's out here is absolutely saturated now. So, but that aside, I'm going to give it till at least another couple of 3 hours here and then make the move down to 16 if nothing happens. If nothing happens at all. So all we can do is play it by ear. The fish that we're seeing here are too far across. I'm not going to go and interfere with another angler's water. We just have to wait and see. But when you stand in peg 16, in all fairness, I stood here yesterday and it felt right. There were fish on that wind line. Not many, but and the shows we're seeing, other than up there, are real subtle. You know, they know we're here. So the pressured waters, I'm rambling, but I'm thinking on my feet at the same time. I think by lunchtime, I'll probably be in peg 16 from the way things are going at the moment, unless one of these whizzes off. Or unless Ant gets another 3-pound catfish and we might stay then. And that come right in the middle of cooking a lovely curry. Thank you, Ant, but the curry was nice. But there you go, I'll leave you with that thought. That hopefully I'll be back on to you in a little while with a great big 40-pound mirror carp or a common, but we'll wait and see. I'll give it another couple of 3 hours. Nothing's happened, if nothing is showing in my side of the lake, I'll be loading the barra and moving the 200 yards down the bank. So not something I really want to do, but something that we're going to have to do. And breathe. Well, we have moved. I did say we'd have to. There were so many big fish in about an hour spell showing along here between these sort of snaggy bits here and the swans. We had to do it. I say we, there's a monumental task moving because we've got all the camera equipment and most people won't. And I'm not being detrimental to you guys, sometimes I won't. But when the fish are showing here and we're up there, we want to catch fish, you've got to do it. So it was a mammoth task, about 10 barrowfuls, but we're here now, I'm breathing again. What I've done is I've put three rods, probably 3 or 4, maybe 5 yards short of the reed line, with the boat, with the little RT4. Just a boatload of bait, 2 on little wafter rigs, and 1 on my hard-earned and well-proven flick rig. So, that's where we're at the moment. Since putting the baits out, I've had 2 big fish show over the left rod. So, I don't think we'll have to move from here again. I feel so confident in this peg that we should have been here yesterday, but we went on our own accord, Jesse. You've got to follow your own heart. We thought we'd do all right up there. We haven't, so we've moved. That's that. Moving on from that, I'm now going to sit myself down, put the kettle on, and tie up a couple of spare of these little wafter rigs with the curved hooks that I'm using. So I'll get you to join me, and I'll knock one or two of them in to show you what I'm using, okay? Get over here then. Right. On 2 of the rods, we've got lovely little wafter rigs. It's not all about great big boilies, because I have put them out of the boat, and I've put a lot of particle in the boat, so we want something that's fairly relative to what we're using. 15-pound captive, coated hook link. I'm going to strip off, 4 or 5 inches. Like so, and cut off best part of about 1 foot. I want it quite long, the hook link, to be finished with, because it is quite stodgy out there. When I reeled him in at the other end, you had to lift the lead out. So that's explained that. Now I've got a size 4. These fish have got big mouths. A size 4
curve hook from our range, and what I'm doing here is I'm going to knotless knot it. So we're going to go about 7, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which leaves about a quarter to a half an inch of peel back there, okay, which is your flexible bit. I'm not using shrink tubing or kickers on this. I'm keeping it about as simple as I can. Small little stainless ring over the point, and I'm just going to position that before I tie it opposite the barb on the hook, which is where I want it to sit once the rig is finished. Okay, a little look at that. Your tag end. Now that is important, so it doesn't slip. I'll go through it once and then twice. Okay, leaving the loop quite proud, because again, that tag end, I want it to go through once and twice. And then pull it down nice and tight. There's your blowback opposite the barb on the hook, which is exactly where I want it. Okay. Oh, well, I like this. I used to use tubing, and you'd reel in and the tubing would be back down by the knotless knot. But whether that was on a cast or whether it happened or a fish had done it, I don't like that. I like this rig to reset itself, because let's be right, every fish that touches that rig, as much as we think it does, it isn't going to hook it. So if you've got a group of fish, the next one that picks it up may just be your one. Now I just whip a little overhand knot to create the hair, which is about the trickiest thing out of all of it, because it's a very simple rig to tie. Get that round there, lay it beneath it, and put it through with my little boiling needle to create a loop to put the bait on, like so. Show you that in a sec. Cut off the excess, boom, gone. There, prior to putting the bait on, is a very simple yet very effective rig. Flexi thing of about half an inch, as I said. A nice big stainless ring on it, so it resets itself, and a big, strong, sharp hook. I'd use this at home as well. This isn't just for France, because I like fishing for big ones on occasion. So there you go. Now what I've got on there is a little pineapple and cream wafter, a tiny bit of plastic on it, one of the tiny bits of plastic corn. The other one just splitting it. With our little pop-ups, with this size hook, it just about wafts its way down. So I'll show you that now. That's where we're at. Quite a gap between hook and bait, which I like. Again, we're talking big fish here. Nice separation. That's how I want it to sit on the bottom, like a claw. Now all I do to finish that, I want this rigger probably getting on for about a foot long. Big fish, and it is very silty out there. A lot of muck on the bottom. So again, double it over. Give that little thing a twist. Pull that through to create a nice loop, which goes on your quick change thing on your rig. Carefully place it on the floor, you notice that, didn't you? Pull that nice and tight, trim it off, and there you go. It doesn't even need steaming, this one, so that's going to go down, sit like so. There's your quick change rig, clip on the rig, a nice heavy bomb, and there we are, about a foot hook length, super strong, super sharp, wafts down. Now when I've put this out with a boat, I've put two pop-ups in a little bag, which I will also show you, because I want the rig, I'll keep emphasising on this soft bed of the lake out there, I'll hook them on, pop. So when the boat drops, pop, that will sit up for a few seconds till the PVA melts, then it will gradually fall down on top of the load of hemp and corn that I've had in the boat. So that, hopefully, next time you see one of these rigs, it will be in a mouth that big and a fish this big. Bear with me. As the day draws to an end, it's easy to forget that we've been fishing about 30 hours now,
I guess, and second peg we've been in, which shows effort. But the area we're in, as I said earlier, happier here than yesterday. There's a lot of fish shown late afternoon at range where we've positioned the rods. There's also been about three show where we moved from yesterday. We can only be in one swim at a time and make the choice that's in your heart at the time. So this is where we are. Ever hopeful as usual. It's flat calm now. The wind dropped off. It was quite warm this afternoon. Entirely different than yesterday. So we'll see. Very, very, very confident. Nice purple sky over there, which means it might well be a good day tomorrow again. And if I don't see you in the night, I actually really hope I'll see you in the morning. So there you go. Well, good morning. Nothing to report in the night. Old Keith had one outside the house, a 47 something last night. And nothing to report here, I'm afraid to say. I'm gonna blame the temperature. We always blame summer, don't we? It was at least -5 last night, and I wasn't prepared for that, I've got to tell you. But I heard a good few fish along the reeds over there. The rods are still in position. We'll see what that brings. My intentions are, yesterday from about mid-morning till sort of early afternoon, a lot of fish showed over there where the reeds end, and I put a rod over there with my little boat. Clearly nothing's happened, but I did walk round to peg 3 earlier while I watched the rods, and it's an 80 yard, maybe 90 yard cast to what it was showing. If that starts happening again today, just literally for something to do and get out of this peg for a while, I'll pull the rods in, put flick rigs on, all three rods with little yellow and pink pop-ups, and go around there and lay them on the floor for a little while. So that's the plan at the moment. Keep your hands warm. It is so cold. This breeze is so cold. Play it by ear, really. You know, I'm only two nights in. We've got another couple of nights left yet, so I'm not going to panic. It is the stage where normally, if I was on my own, I'd be running around like a lunatic. But there's nothing to run around like a lunatic on at the moment. So keep me head together. You know, it could all happen on the third or the fourth night. Just the way it is. The weather's took a turn for the worse. Can't control that. Keith, where he's normally getting them from, there's obviously a pod of fish up there. He's had a 48 and a 47 in the last few days. But there is a pod of fish over there, or there was yesterday. We'll wait and see what happens this morning. And by lunchtime, we'll have a little bit more info from you as to what we're going to do for the rest of the day. Till then, I'm going to warm my hands up. Happening here, we're at midday now. I haven't even seen anything, if I'm honest, in the water I'm fishing. So, where Keith had one last night, down that end, I'll be nowhere near it, but where I parked the van, when I got here 2 days ago, I put 2 or 3 key of pellet and a little bit of boilie in the edge against some reeds in the side, about 4 foot of water. So I'm gonna go down there, get out of the swim for a couple of hours, and who knows, might come out for 50 pounder. Thank you. walked off down the path with my barra. I've been putting a little bit of corn in the corner here, and a few 12mm 24/7s. And wouldn't you believe it? Keith gets a bite, 47lb 12 ounces. I get a bite, and it's a little tiny bar of soap. But you can't pick up, or you rather you can't pick what picks it up. So there you go, there's my two evenings sneaking down baiting up. There was others here, the line was twitching. One of the tiny babies of the lake has ripped off with it, so as I say, you can't pick what picks it up. But it does show you one thing. Getting on the train or on the ferry doesn't automatically mean you're going to catch hippopotamus-sized carp, does it? So I'm going to slip in back now and then go back and get the main rods back out and leave a little bit of bait in here. Maybe tomorrow, if the conditions are the same, I'll walk up and it might be my turn for a 47. Till then, we'll slip in back. Sooner have I finished my bangers and spuds, and I nearly had a heart attack. The left hand rod, which is fished a fair way across there to be fair with my little boat, just pulled up two or three bleeps. Now there's a lot of line out there, a lot of nylon, and I was just waiting for the tip before I pick it up. If there's a fish on, I'll know about it within a few seconds, but I don't know. There is a coop working out there. You don't usually get liners with tight line at probably about 170 yards. Fingers crossed, it hasn't bleeped again. Three little bleeps, so maybe it was a fish. Maybe pulling a bit of line about. There'll be a reason for it, but it hasn't. I was just literally waiting for the tip to start curving round, and then we'd have had our fish, but it hasn't gone any further, so we'll sit tight. Oh dear, ever hopeful. Well, good evening. Today's been different. We still haven't had a whopper. I was feeding the corner up there from when I arrived up where the van's parked with a bit of pellet, a little bit of sweet corn, a load of 12mm 24/7 boilies, and keeping my eye on it. Well, Keith had a fish last night, 47 pounds. Although it was on the other side and his swim. I kept nipping down and saw some tail patterns in that corner. It's about 4 foot of water, and I'm thinking, 4 foot? They've got to be big ones, haven't they? So grabbed the rod, shot down this afternoon, pulled all this in, just left the swim alone for a while. It was nice to get out of the peg. Was only there about 20 minutes, and with the tail patterns going, I couldn't believe it. Absolutely can't believe this. Off goes the rod. I actually thought it was going to be a big bream, and it was a wild common carp, about 5 pounds. So I've had a carp. Not quite what we come to France for, but we've had a carp. So it's looking interesting up this end now. The wind's dropping. It's really, really warm for the evening. Who knows? You know, we're going into our third night now. Keith, to be fair, since we've got here, has lost a sturgeon and had a 47. So there's only been one carp bite other than that little stalked one. I've rebaited the corner. If the conditions are the same tomorrow, I'll have another look. Till then, it's back on the bobbins. Please, just one big whopper. Vanilla latte time. Okay, now bringing you up to speed. I was up at first light, nothing happened in the night at our end of the lake, and I cannot begin to tell you just how cold this northeasterly is. I still don't think we're in the wrong area. Keith, I don't know what he had. He did have another fish. First light, daytime bite, which is his first one in weeks and weeks. So I don't know what he's had. I did pop down there earlier, put a little bit of bait in that corner where I nicked that little common yesterday, and I put my bait boat batteries on charge. So that is that. As I started saying, I don't think we're naturally in the wrong area. There was fish here last night, quite a lot of fish, the most activity we've seen. I just think that a couple of lifts on the long rod, maybe they're not quite committing. Midday I'm going to go down and have a look in the corner again, maybe have an hour or two up there just to get out the swim. When I put these out again for bite time in the night time, a few little rig twitches, little changes, so I'll... whatever I do, I'll show you this evening. I haven't decided what to do yet. But that long rod yesterday, just an inch lift. I mean, that's 180 yards out. So a lift, and it stayed lifted. I think something's just moved that lead and rig and got away with it. Now, let's not fool ourselves. This happens all the time. Knowing it's happening at about 180 yards is almost impossible. But I fish long enough to know we'll make a couple of little changes later. So... 12 o'clock, I'm going to pull these in, go and get my boat battery back and have a little go up in that corner, hopefully. 3 or 4 o'clock, I'll be back here and readdress these. If I make changes, I'll fill you in on it. If I don't, I won't. But we've still got another couple of hours yet before I want to wander off. Not seen a single fish break surface this morning, but last night in the dark, they were dancing and they are big, big fish. So, big, big fish need to eat. So, I'm just getting it wrong. Even in 1% wrong is enough to change a week from loads of big fish into what we've got at the moment. Not despondent, going to keep smashing at it. Who knows? They are out there, down to me to catch them. So keep you informed.
Well, what do I say, Ronnie or Reggie? Just pulling the long rod in, and this come up out of the water about 80 yards out, clinging to my line. So check your line on waters like this. I didn't even realise we had these, but I suppose being France, there's going to be plenty of them. But who knows, maybe the carp are more on these at the moment than they are on, well, they clearly are, than what we're giving them. But there you go. I'll check that line. It's not damaged, to be fair, but yeah. Yards and yards and yards out in the lake. I thought it was a bit of weed hanging off the line. It's little Reggie, should I say, and Ronnie. I think we should put him back though, shouldn't you? He is a creature of nature. Toodle. Yesterday, I had a tiny little common right at the edge behind us. I remember saying there was tail patterns there, 4 foot of water, and I felt as if I'd been a bit unlucky, although I got a bite. We've been sharing the swim 1 hour at a time, and to be fair, when my cameraman, I went in first, had the first hour. Then I too was away and sorted some stuff out with Keith, and took over the rod, repositioned it. 20 minutes later, 31 and a half. So all I can say is,
well done. We've worked and hard for it.
We have, mate. The lake, I do feel, has been a bit unkind to us, but there you go. We've had a common each now. We could have used mine as bait for this one, but all the same, what a fish. We're both off the mark, be it a big one or a little one. So, but both right out the edge, whereas up the other end we're fishing, I don't know, 180 yards out.
Yeah.
These have
yeah.
come, lowering it in the edge with a 10-foot rod. So, what, obviously, 10 foot off the bank. Let's nip it back then, mate.
Okay.
And then back to the main rods.
That's a bad fish. Right, here we go.
Well, after ruining, or should we say ant, ruining my stalking spot, we've dropped on the little lake near the van where we'd also put some bait. And lo and behold, we've had 4 bream, and this is a very good mirror. A very, very good mirror, that is. So there you go, from a little pond. What do they go up to in here, Keith?
We've got a map time, we've got a common in here, tarpon's nudging 51, maybe even more, because a lot of bait went in here last year. 7 around the 40 plus mark, and then what's been in here since the, like, it's been a venue, so like you've got 20 years of fish being in here, you know?
This is a mirror.
You know, so I'm just going to say, I reckon this will be mid 30 by the look of this.
Oh, it's big fish.
It's big fish. This holds some prizes, this lake, I'm telling you, it really does. That's why it's called the fun lake, you know.
This is a fish, mate. Look at him. He's a good fish, ain't he? Big bream.
Got that up.
That is a big. No.
No. No.
No. No. No. The biggest bream I've ever caught, mate. Oh, look at him. Don't want to go in there, does he? But
he has
gone in there.
Well done, that man.
Ah! Carps are carps are carp, mate. That's a big carp. Tell you what, he's a very big carp. Look at him.
Very nice.
Getting one back on end. It's not out of big lake, it's out of Keith's little lake, his little caravan lake. But when Ant blew us out of the water, was ruining the stalking spot, should we say, this little lake is right by the van. And we've been pinging a few boilies around this island behind me, and there you go. We've had 2 bream each, and we were calling it the bream match on the little rods. And this has ruined the bream match, but let me tell you, I think that's won it, don't you? 35.5 pounds. We've had 3 carp now from 2 different lakes. But you are beautiful. And that thought, like, it thought I was a French bloke and I was going to eat it. But I'm not. I'm going to put him back. So we're slipping back. And then it's time to go back to our main swim and hopefully get one out of there. There you go. Just before we nip back to our peg on the main lake. Thank you very much. Bye bye, darling. Chuffed a bit for that. Absolutely made up with that capture. We'll be right back.
just tinkering here. I'll bring you up to speed on today. It's been a completely, I've only got a hoodie on, not a coat, and a hood, and a bobble hat. Today's been fantastic, really, in relation to what we've gone through this week. Went up there stalking. Now, I'll run you through it as it's all happened. We decided yesterday, I had a little one out of this main lake yesterday, out of the edge up there, we've been feeding them. Fed it last night. I went up there at first light, put another big couple of big handfuls of 12mm 24/7s right in the edge. Wandered up there. No tail patterns like yesterday, but fine. They're in and out. So I've laid the rig in there. Now, we've been taking it in turns, myself and Ant, on the rod. So I had an hour, in all fairness. Then I lifted it out. I had to go around and see Keith, get some batteries charged and all that for the little boat for this evening. And lo and behold, I get back in the swim. Ant's hour's nearly up. Off it goes. Just about right, isn't it, for my cameraman? I've got to listen, I love this man, so he couldn't happen to a better person. 31 and a half, long missile common that give us the run around in that little corner. But fantastic to get one of us to get a proper carp and get on the map. So it's about the two of us here, and that's that. So after he'd ruined the corner with that 31 and a half pound common, the other side of the van is what Keith calls his caravan lake. I'm guessing it's about 2.5-3 acres. We looked in there yesterday, put a bit of bait in, with just half hour, an hour, if something, you know, if you saw anything. So we went on there, because the corner had been blown up. And bream straight away to Ant, then me, so we've turned it into a bit of fun. We're going to cut off at 3 o'clock and come back for the main rod, same as yesterday. Now we're on 2-all on the bream, and it's brilliant. There's little bubbles everywhere, and we're having a bream match now, on carp gear, granted, but we're having a bream match. Pinging 12 mils, out in the open water to the left and right of the island, catching bream. Keith walks up, 2:45. I'm looking at the watch thinking, I'll pull that in a minute, and we better make our way back to the main rods. And beep, 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 liner, which can't really be the little bream because they're only 2 and 3 pound fish. Wallop. Long drawn out, fire. I'm blown away by that. Now, I know it's on the little lake, but we're anglers, and wherever there's a fish, we're going to fish for them. And it was a respite from being on it, to be fair. After about 5, 6, 7 minutes, up pops a 35 and a half pound deep-bodied mirror, which was totally unexpected, and it won me the bream match. So, on that note, we're out another 15 minutes, then we obviously weigh slings, photos, a little bit of filming, covered in slime. Time to come back down here. The weather's so nice now. From this morning, it was absolutely freezing. This is lovely. Very light breeze. A couple of fish since we've been back here. This is the best conditions we've had in this peg all week. Three guys on the opposite side and all now, which may make a difference to us, because if there's been fish holding up over there with no lines, we all know it on busy day tickets and that, it will shift the fish once the leads and that go in. They may move back in there tonight, they may not even move out. But since getting back here, we've seen a couple of free fish along this reed line. Ant was ready before me, so we buzzed his across there with a boat. I've done him a pulled pork and chilli sensation crisp sandwich. Yep, a wrap, I've done that. And he's only just eaten it, which takes about 4 seconds of Ant. And the left-hand rod is lit up. Bang, wallop. Now, a long drawn-out fight again, because it's about, I'm guessing it's about 180 yards with the little boat. What you've got is it's 5 and 4s all the way across here. We've got the sounder on. So, and as you literally, I'm saying to him, you've got to drop it, you've got to drop it. It looks like you're hitting the reeds, that range, because it is deceiving. It then drops to 4.5 and 5, literally against them reeds. That's where he plopped it in, and it was all joking aside about the sandwich. It took about a minute, not 10 seconds, and off it's gone. Well, there you go. What do I want me to say? Chuffed a bit. It's hung up in the edge there. We're doing this little bit of footage now. We've got all the rods out now by this one. I've just changed the rigs over, and then we'll show you this common that Ant's caught. It's beautiful, big, deep-bodied. We're getting a bit of runaway with it. Bear in mind, we ain't caught anything all week. We both estimated this fish are probably mid and upper, but 30 and a half pounds, you could not be more grateful. That's 3 fish out of the main lake now, all commons, 1 out the little lake. We'll have another little go tomorrow afternoon, if it's dead here in the afternoon, early afternoon, on the little lake. But till then, I did touch on this morning, I want to get my bait. I love the flick rig, but I need to get these baits, I think. I've had a couple of little pull-ups, and I think they've got away with it, lower to the bed of the lake. Okay, so what I've done here, I've tied up on our CRVs. Each rod now has got something I've never used. I've got to say, it's a Ronnie rig. But my friends use them. They do really well on them, and I'll put them out there now. My faith is running on my friends' backs now, so
Ronnie rigs. I'll get this rod out there and I'm going to whip a few more up later and put them on my little rig board. So if you come back to me a little bit later, we'll show you how I make them, which is basically copying everybody else. So, haha, there you go. Time I got this rod in play. Get away, mate. Sorry.
Yep.
Right. Now, not 2 minutes ago, I sent this rig out in my little Brapton bird's eye boat, and I mean not certainly no more than 5 minutes, if that, and it's just gone whack. It's hit the rod, and it's a bit of a race now because they're clearly a long way out, and I've also got a very snaggy margin down to my left, so I want to get in within 50 yards of safe zone without risking losing him as quickly as you blooming well can. But he is kiting like crazy, this one. Turn and go the other way, please. There's still a 100 odd out there at the moment, still a well over 100 yards out, and he's still going slowly left.
Now look at that. Not 10 minutes ago I showed you a Ronnie rig that was going to be the first ones I've ever used. Look at it now, stuck in a hippo's mouth. Now he was confident. How things have changed, eh? How things have changed. Let's get him out of there and get him weighed up.
How mad's this, eh? For a bit of sport now. It's all turning nice and warm. We've just lifted out. We've got ants, I'll catch up with you. We've got ants 30 odd common in a retainer. Just lifted it out of the water. Well, we were just going to lift it out of the water, and I had a 40 pound 4 ounce mirror. So we've dropped that in a retainer. We've gone to lift ants common out of the water again. A little bit of footage. And off it goes again. The right end rod this time, not the one that I've just put back out there. But this will slow the action down because it's 180 yards. I can't cast 180 yards and the boat battery is dead. So we'll be grateful for what we've got. We've got to get him in yet. But playing them low like this generally brings them up in the water. A little trick took to me years ago by the one and only Keith Arthur, funny enough. And I was in a fishing match, fishing over gravel bars at extreme range. I'm trying to pull them over them, and he said, no, go against the grain, play them low, and they lift up in the water. Well, there isn't any gravel bars here, but it did start kiting and hitting my other rod. So that's why I started playing him low to drop the line under. I'd like to have the rod eye and see whereabouts he is because of that margin, but that will do. So what we might do, granted, we get this in. God, do you know, I think it's the same fly that's been doing me all afternoon, because obviously I smell. When we get it, we might just well, granted, we get this in, weigh and photograph it while the other two are still in retainers and deal with it.
much, Mr. Miracle. Thank you. Oh, thank you, thank you. You know what, don't you just love carp fishing? The ups, the downs, the cold, the warm, the disappointments, all going on in your nut. What am I doing wrong? What am I doing wrong? Most of the time, you know, done it for so long, you're not doing anything wrong. It just isn't happening. This afternoon proves that. And I've proved it time and time again in my life, but I still sit there the same as everybody else thinking, what am I doing wrong? Nothing. Just got to wait for them to want it. Right, we're doing this one before we do ants because it's just hit the net. 34, just over 30, 34 pounds of lovely Lac de Premiere Mirror Carp. We've waited 3 days to get some bites, and as per usual, don't they just arrive like buses? We are not complaining. We are definitely not complaining. Now, look at the fins on that. We'll get a closer look in a minute. They're not really worn out, but I don't know. I've seen it at home on some gravel pit fish. Tiny little fins, look like they're worn out. Maybe it's genetic, but they are tiny, tiny. This one's called Nemo. Now look at that. Tiny little stub fins on him, and the bottom one. Not the anal one though, just the dorsal. So there we have him. 34, before we do ants common. Thank you. Let's stick him back. Now look at you, the aforementioned low 30 common for ant. Straight back from stalking, he's got one barbel, oh no, he's got two barbels. Right, mate. Straight back from stalking, tended ants rods first because they were ready and mine had been used up there. And within a sandwich, boom, got one mate from the far reed line. So brilliant mate, brilliant. So this gentleman today has had a 31 and a half at that end of this lake, 2 foot off the bank. And a 30 and a half at this end of the lake, 180 yards off the bank. So, mate, it's great. We've waited a long time. They're starting to turn up. Well done, buddy.
Thank you.
Well done, buddy. Right. There we go. 40 pound, 4 ounces. Third fish between us in about 45 minutes off that far reed line. 180 yards away. There we are. That is one beautiful, clean Lac de Premiere Mirror Carp. Thank you very much. Often said, one more look, and then she's going back. God bless. There we go. Right, couple of steals now.
Well, what a difference 24 hours in your life can make. Last night at this time, we weren't filming in the dark, granted, I was sitting there with a hoodie up, a bobble hat on, and a fleece. Now look at it. The difference in 24 hours is 6 carp today. And that is lovely, isn't it? It's mega, mega mild, just starting to rain. Hopefully, not being greedy, but hopefully we'll get a few more either tonight or tomorrow for you. And with that note, I'm going to bed because I'm knackered. Hello.
Nothing's happened in the night, but nothing's happened any night for us. After a spell of action,
late yesterday afternoon, early evening. Seen a few this morning at that end up near the house. There is an empty peg there, peg 13, which incidentally is my lucky number. So we're going to sit where we are till lunchtime, and then we may just pack the whole camp down. We've got to be off early tomorrow morning as well. That's definitely a factor in it. So we may just break the camp down, and I'm looking up there now. Another one's just shown in front of peg 13. But what you've also got up there is where the van's parked. Peg 13 is one side of it, and that other little lake is directly behind the van, so we could split and one fish each. So, but that decision will be made lunchtime. I've seen one thing this morning here, and I pulled a rod in and put on it. About 40 yards out, it started blowing like crazy, which is the middle rod, the bobbin's down, because I'm fishing closer in. So I've thrown just two bits of plastic, ironically enough, at it. And who knows, it hasn't stopped blowing. There's been little bits and the odd little liner. It's been about 10 minutes now. So that's what's happened in the night, which is absolutely zero. But we'll move and have a sort out about lunchtime. Till then, we've still got two rods long. My little battery on my little boat is dead. So we're not going to bother with that today. We'll leave the rods bang on them reeds where we had the bites yesterday. Till lunchtime, we make a decision. I'm rambling. But till then, I'm now going to go make a cup of tea and a bacon butty, as the northerners say. Butty. I'd have said sarnie if it was southern. Butty. And then I'll show you the rig I caught them fish on. It keeps drawing my eye. I do apologise because it's still blowing there now. I'll show you the rig I had them fish on yesterday, and also talk you through an exciting new range of terminal gear that we've got coming out soon. So, bacon sarnie time. Change of rig yesterday. Now, whether or not that made the difference out there, it made a difference on this end of my rod. So I took off. I'd had a couple of little short pulls on my favourite flick rig, but I have come across a few venues where they obviously feed different. So making changes is what it was about. I changed over to a big hook. I'll build it up like this for you first of all. CRV. These are very, very sharp, very, very strong. I use these an awful lot. If I'm using wafters, bottom baits in England, other than my long shank, which is a pop-up usually, but these are the ones. They are so, so sharp and so strong. The boom I use nearly all the time for, again, I can relate this to my flick rig, is 45 pound pin down. It's so supple, it lays over. If your lead buries, a stiff boom's gonna stick up like that. This drops down and lays over all the little stones, pebbles, twigs. And it's really, really heavy, really soft, and it's so tough, it's incredible. That is what I use for a lot of my booms, which I used yesterday. So, what we've got here is a little ring swivel with a hook on the end of it. Now this, I'm gonna put on a little bit of our outline camouflaged shrink tubing, which you'll be seeing in the very near future. So that's where we are with it at the moment. A little ring swivel with a hoop on it and into the hoop. Okie dokie, simple as that. Now, pinch that back together like so. I'll show you that when I've done it. Pinch that back together so that hook is not going to come off there. Slide the shrink tube down till it's halfway. I've been guided by other anglers that I've seen do this rig, but till it almost covers the barrel on the swivel. So you've still got the rotary going on. Then on there now, a small hook swivel, which is clearly for bait attachment. That's on there now. And one of our tiny, tiny, this is why the glasses are on, by the way, tiny, tiny hook beads, which I can't even see the bead without the glasses, let alone the hole in the bead. And I'll slide that up over, if you're using barbs, the barbs on the hook. Now there you go, other than shrink tubing it, that's done. So, 45 pound pin down, size 4, very strong, very sharp CRV hook, little ring swivel with a hook on it, goes through the back of the eye, shrink tube down. Kettle is boiling, as you can see. I'm going to drop that in there and I'll bring it back and show you. Only needs a couple of seconds. Be careful with the boiling water, that has to be said. And there we go. That, as they call it, is the Ronnie. Very, very easy to set up. I can't believe, in all fairness, I haven't tried it till now, and that is the honest truth, I haven't. And the first two drops out there of my little boat yesterday resulted in a 40 pound an ounces mirror and a 34 plus mirror, so, and they were proper nailed. So I think, like me, some of you are gonna get on the Ronnie. Right, I'm just gonna talk you through this terminal gear I've been using. It's from our Outline range of terminal tackle. It's flecked, it's coloured, it's camoed, if you like. I'll talk you through why I'm using this setup here, then we'll talk about that. The bed of the lake is out. I'm a lead clip man, by the way. I rarely, if ever, use a helicopter system, but so the lead clip. What I'm using over there is big heavy leads, and imagine now we've got a really soft lake bed. That could sink in and disappear like that. What I'm getting at now is the boom section. If that was a nylon one or a stiff boom, as that sinks in, that'll push up and sit off the lake bed like a boom, like a wand actually, rendering it, you know, fairly useless. With this 45 pound pin down, which I use a huge amount on my flick rigs, anything that I'm tying a small stiff boom to on the end, look at how supple that is. It lays over everything. That's buried now 2 inches in the silk, and there's your 2 inches, and that's still gonna be presented and fishing. So, 45 pound pin down for that. Onto the Outline terminal setup. The color on this is unbelievable. If you wanna call it, you know, it's a camo, but it blends in so well. We've got normal lead clip, which has got a quick change link already inside it, which is showing you there. Anti-tangle tubing, which I use a lot on my rigs, self-explanatory. Lead clip, obviously. Now this is ribbed on the top, so you put your towel rubber on as hard or as soft as you want, whether you want to regulate losing the lead or keeping the lead, okay? So this is Outline terminal gear. Now put this in the lake, it blends in with every lake bed I've ever fished on. I've used it for months now and it is fairly phenomenal stuff. I think so anyway. Now, when you buy some of this and put it in the lake bed, you'll be able to check it out, or will ya? Wildies for a reason. We've packed up now for peg 16 and we've moved, certainly for the daylight hours, on the caravan lake. We're off, as I said earlier, we're off home very early in the morning tomorrow. The van's right there. It makes sense. Have a few hours here. We'll decide later whether we're going to go in peg 13 by lucky number on the main lake or just stay here for the night. It's not a drama. We'll get a few of these. At least we're getting bites, aren't we? Well, we had a nice one over yesterday, so there's a wildie. 20 minutes after putting the rigs in. Now, incidentally, on here, it's a tiny little lake and it's lovely. There's a few carp here, so it's a bit of fun. And I love fishing, and I love fun fishing. But it's nicer on here to be not fishing at 180 yards with a remote control boat with bits of rubber, two or three little catapults of 12mm 24/7s, and a little pop up. Carp fishing, I'm loving it. Thank you.
Nothing to say really. Nothing to say at all. Just finished our dinner, supplied by Keith and his missus, and Mrs. Keith. And I was taking the mick out of Ant because he's put code red on. We are going to stay on this little lake tonight and hopefully have a bit of fun. But he's put code red out, which is renowned for being a cat attractor. And I thought, do you know what? I put a little code red wafter on with a little bag of them an hour ago. And look, that bait, for me, is the biggest draw of any carp, but it also draws these things in. Look at it. That is disgusting. So, and when it rolled, the man behind the camera actually joked because he hadn't seen it. He said, oh, I think it's a little cat. There you go. He was right. Well, hopefully we won't see any more of these. Look at it. It's doing a toilet. Oh, my God. Well, hopefully we won't see any more of these tonight. We won't disrespect it. We'll put him back. He is lovely. He's what it seems to be part of the lake, so I don't want it to poo on me though, but that would be quite unpleasant. Put him back. But Keith has said there's a couple of albinos in here, big albino cats. Now, oh my behave! Right, on that note, I'm keeping hold of him, I'm gonna put him back. Same rod as the catfish, new code red water, and look what we have this time. It's like the fishing race. Now this never even ended. This was either going to be a substantial sized carp or a small cat again. What the hell is that all about? Now Ant, sitting behind the camera yet again, would love to catch one of these and would love to catch a catfish tonight. Really? Look at this. It's like a shark that's been stretched in one of them old mangles my mum used to use for tea towels. That is disgusting. Absolutely disgusting. But, like the cat, he has come along. He is part of the lake. So, got to take what comes, haven't we? We had a lovely afternoon here on this little lake. And we're going to do, I don't know if I want to do the night, to be honest, but what else is in here that can get caught? Carp, cat, sturgeon, what else lurks beneath the surface? Right, last fish of the trip. Can you believe my little friend here actually wanted to catch one of these? He went over the far corner, put in a whole 1.75 kilos of 80 mil code reds, and look, it's toileting again. They are just disgusting. He wanted to catch one, to be fair. It's a nice size fish, if that's what you're after. And bang, what we put in, ours was red.
That's 24/7.
That's 24/7, mate. He's been scooping everywhere. But he wanted this fish, he got this fish, more in than me. Anywhere you put code red, these things find it. So your game plan worked, buddy.
Yep.
So anyway, on that note, we've got a train to catch and a van to load. Well, as you can see, that's our little trip over. What a place. Although we worried at the start, we have ended up with a good few fish from both lakes and even some weird and wonderful creatures that showed up on the last night. So with that in mind, I've got a train to catch, a long journey ahead of me, and I need to go and have a coffee with the host and his missus, Keith. So there we go. That's me out of here. Sorry, did you cough for me then? way, mate. Sorry. Look at it. He's doing a toilet. Oh my God.
I haven't noticed you putting any boilies out. Did you put some boilies out? What?